one that's here this evening. Our first song will be number 406. 406. I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk, dear Lord, close to thee. Just a closer walk with granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Through this world of toils and snares, if I falter, Lord, who cares? Who with me my burden shares? None but thee, dear Lord, none but thee. Just a closer walk with granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. When my feeble life is o'er, time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, safely o'er, to thy kingdom shore, to thy shore. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Number 572. I walk with the Savior each step of the way. I trust Him to guide by night and by day, not dreading tomorrow, nor what it may bring. I'm safe in the keeping of Jesus the King. Each step of the way, by night and by day, leads nearer the home, eternally fair, where we shall meet loved ones awaiting us there, who walked here with Jesus each step of the way. With joy we shall enter the city up there of wonderful beauty and mansions all fair. His own shall be changed and made like him that day, because we walked with him each step of the way, each step of the way, by night and by day. Leads nearer the eternally fair, where we shall meet loved ones awaiting us there, who walked here with Jesus each step of the way. Next song will be number 683. 683, following this song, I'll ask John Sublett to lead us in prayer. I am mine no more, I am mine no more, I've been bought with blood, I am mine no more. Jesus is my Lord, Jesus is my Lord, and he rules my life. Jesus is my Lord. He will come again. He will come again. And he'll take me home. He will come again. I am mine no more, I am mine no more, I've been bought with blood, I am mine no more.
Dear God, we're so thankful that you have given us this opportunity to once again gather together on this first day of the week to worship you and sing praises to you. And Father, remember your Son and the sacrifice that he made for us. We're just so thankful that you gave us an avenue for sanctification through your Son Jesus. Father, we pray that everything that we do here this evening, the songs that we lift up to you, the prayers that we lift up to you, the portion of your word that we study, we pray that all of this will be done according to your will, and it will be uplifting to you. Father, we mentioned several this morning from our number that are suffering with illnesses. We pray that you'd be with doctors that are giving them care, that it be thy will that they might be healed and return to us as soon as possible. Once again, Father, we just thank you so much for your plan of salvation and the love that you have shown to us. In your Son Jesus' name, amen.
396. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus, no, not one, no, not one. None else can heal all our souls' diseases, no, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. No friend like him is so high and holy. No, not one. No, not one. And yet no friend is so meek and lowly. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. There's not an hour that he is not near us. No, not one. No, not one. No night so dark but his love can cheer us. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one.
If you'd like to mark your books, number 912 will be the song of encouragement after the lesson. And then let's turn to 129. If it's convenient, let's be standing.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already
shining as the sun, with no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
Be seated.
Good evening. Good to see everyone. Beautiful day outside. We're all used to it by now, aren't we? I don't think it matters. It's going to come anyway, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. We are going to talk about the reward of the righteous tonight in our next lesson in our series of lessons about last things. This lesson will pretty much finish up the section that comes together with the return of Jesus and the judgment and the resurrection, and now we talk about the punishment of the wicked. We're going to talk about the reward of the righteous. Next week, I want to kind of backtrack just a little bit to, we talked about the return of Jesus and what Scripture says about it. I want to spend a couple, three lessons talking about some misconceptions or some error that is taught in the religious world with regard to the second coming. So we'll do that next week, and I guess thinking about the calendar, the next week we'll skip because it's singing, and then we'll pick back up third, fourth. I believe this is the fifth Sunday, if I remember right. Anyway, one of the most exciting promises that Jesus made is that heaven is, or your reward in heaven is great. Matthew 5 and verse 12. We who are Christians have hope of a life in heaven that far exceeds this life as far as the glory and everything that's involved with it. No other people have so many songs about heaven and sing so frequently about that future home. Our expectation of heaven carries us with joy through many trials and burdens. Drives others to sorrow and despair. The New Testament gives us much more to look forward to than this life. Although heaven, in the sense of the eternal home of the saved, is not mentioned in scriptures frequently or described in any detail, the blessings of heaven are alluded to. Because I want to cover so much material this evening, I'm going to try to just stay with my notes here in front of me and not ad-lib, as I'm accused of regularly. So, here we go. What is heaven like? Heaven is not a tangible, physical dimension. Because that's true, then we have to realize that any physical terms used to describe it can only hint at the realities of that spiritual realm. That passage on the screen there, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 18, Paul says concerning heaven that we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. When we look at these things that we're going to see, and as we read about them in Scripture, understand that God is describing heaven to us, a spiritual place, a spiritual realm. He's describing it to us in physical, earthly terms. Because that's what we understand. That's what we relate to. That's what we know all about. And so, even though it's talked about in Scripture in earthly terms, we must not think of it as being a physical place or a physical location. Now, in regards to that, this earth is not going to be renovated. It is not going to be changed into some sort of spiritual habitation. If it were, if this earth is going to be changed to a spiritual realm, then we could not take seriously God. Because God said, "Behold, I make all things new." Revelation 21, verse 5. We could not take literally the statement in Revelation 21, verse 1, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away." There will be changes. Heaven is described in Revelation as the New Jerusalem, the city of the saved. And it is described as being made out of the costliest materials that are known on earth. Revelation 21, verses 11 to 21. And we think about those gates of pearl and the streets of gold and all the other gemstones that are mentioned there in describing the foundations and all the things about heaven in that description in Revelation 21. And when we think about those things, it's an awesome picture that God paints for us. Almost beyond our imagination to think about the things that we read there. But it's the picture that God wants us to have as mortals in this present state in which we are. We will all be awe-stricken when we are glorified in His kingdom. What we read is beautiful and great and wonderful, but it's going to be so much better. So much better. Beyond what we can imagine. The good news about heaven is that it will always be and will always be the same. It won't be transitory, passing, like this world we know now. Our hope is an inheritance, incorruptible, or imperishable, undefiled, that will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. 1 Peter 1, verse 4. Heaven is a place described by Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 6 and verse 20, as a place where neither moth nor rust destroys, or where thieves do not break through nor steal. And everyone that enters into heaven will have a new body, described by Paul in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 1 as a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Most wonderful aspect of heaven will be our association throughout all eternity with God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and all the faithful people that have ever lived. We love our fellowships here. We love getting together with brothers and sisters, assembly like this, down the hall in the fellowship hall, in a restaurant where we meet one another. Wherever we get together, we love our fellowship here. But no fellowship on earth can compare with the eternal fellowship that we will have in heaven. Paul wrote in Romans 8:18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us. That glory that we will share in. Number two, what will be in heaven? Symbols are used to help us understand heaven. Reading about what Scripture says, we can understand that heaven will not have the items that we need here on the earth, like the sun, the moon, stars, or even a lamp. We won't need light fixtures, lights like we have now in our buildings or street lights to light up the darkness at night. We won't need all of those things because there will be no night there, and the Lamb will be the light. I didn't get these scriptures on the slide, so let me just read them slowly. Revelation chapter 21, verse 23 and 25. Chapter 22, verse 5. Heaven, we will have ready access to God. So there will be no need for a temple where God's presence is. God and the Lamb will be the temple. Revelation 21, 22. We will not need physical food in heaven. Life will be sustained by the water of the river of life and by the fruit of the tree of life. Revelation 22, verses 1 and 2. We will no longer be away from God because, as Revelation 21, verse 3 says, the tabernacle of God is among men. He will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them. God's throne, the throne of the Lamb, will be there. Because of this, there will be no curse there. Revelation 22, verse 3. Only righteousness will be in our new dwelling place. Here's a question that gets asked a lot. What will we be like in heaven? Our physical bodies will be changed. Spiritual bodies. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 44 and verses 51 to 54. Paul goes to great length in that latter part of 1 Corinthians 15 to make that point. Physical bodies, such as we have now, are not suited for the spiritual dimension of heaven. And thus we will not be able to enter heaven in our physical bodies. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50 says that flesh and blood, physical bodies, cannot inherit the kingdom of God. God's spirit realm is natural for him because he is a spirit. John 4, 20. And the angel, it's natural for the angels, since they also are spirits. Hebrews 1, verse 14. We cannot understand with our minds in our present circumstance what that body is going to be like in that spiritual dimension. But we have the assurance in 1 John 3 and verse 2, as he speaks about Jesus, that when he appears, we will be like him. We will see him as he is. In order for us to see God, we must enter into his dimension. Physical beings cannot see God. 1 Timothy 6:16. In Philippians 3, verses 20 and 21, Paul says that Jesus, quote, will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of his glory by the exertion of the power that he has, even to subject all things to himself. When this happens, we will see his face. Revelation 22:4. A face that none of us in our physical bodies can behold and live. Exodus 33, verse 20. So when we enter into heaven, we will be changed. We will have the glory of heavenly beings. We will be glorified with Christ. Romans 8:17. Having entered into glory, honor, and peace. Romans 2, verses 7 and 10. In our new state, we will shine forth as the Son in the kingdom of the Father. Matthew 13:43. 1 Corinthians 15:49 says, just as we have borne the image of the earthy, we will also bear the image of the heavenly. In other words, we will be eternal beings with eternal life, no longer able to die. Luke 20, verse 36, and Revelation 21, verse 4. And we think most of the time when we talk about eternal life, we think about length of life, that it'll be a long life, an eternal life. The idea of in Scripture of eternal life not only includes that, it also includes quality of life. And that will be a part of the eternal life that is ours. Now, the unrighteous dead, the wicked, will continue living, but their eternal existence is not to be considered eternal life. It is called rather eternal death. Second death, the lake of fire, which we saw last time, 2 weeks ago, Revelation 20, verse 14. Now, there's several questions. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 more questions that I want to go through. And these are questions that are very often brought up and asked about heaven. The first of these is this: what will we be doing in heaven? What are we going to do? Well, God's not given us a full description of what we will be doing in heaven, and perhaps that's for a very good reason that he hasn't done that. We, as physical beings, might not consider what spiritual beings do be very exciting. If we're physical. You know, as a little boy, there were times when I hoped that I would never grow up. You know, that Peter Pan complex. Never going to grow up and be an adult. Because I thought the activities of adults with that. You know, when you think about that, our happiness now in this life is very often based on physical things. So we might have some sort of difficulty getting our heads wrapped around and getting excited about spiritual activities that we will engage in heaven. Scripture does tell us a little bit about what we will be doing there. For example, in heaven, we will know only happiness. Revelation 21, verse 4 says that God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning, crying, first things, those things that are part of this physical life, are passed away. John was inspired to write. There are physical aspects of life that cause us sorrow, and they have been a curse to us. They will no longer exist. The saved will enter into the joy of their master. Matthew 25, verse 21 and 23. And we will get to rest from our toils of this life. Revelation 14, 13. Hebrews 4, verses 8 through 11. Throughout eternity, we will rejoice because we will be with the Father, with Jesus, with the angels, with all of those who are saved. We will joyfully serve Jesus. Revelation 22, 3. We will reign with Him forever. 2 Timothy 2, 12. Revelation 22, 5. Paul said in 2 Thessalonians 1, 10 that Jesus will be glorified in His saints when He returns. That must mean that Jesus is going to be highly honored and revered by those that He has saved, the redeemed. Heaven's going to be a wonderful place, a place of love, fellowship, rejoicing. Beyond that, God hasn't really told us anything more. Here's a very serious question. Who will go to heaven? Jesus said, passage there on the screen, Matthew 7, verse 12, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Hebrews 5 and verse 9, speaking of Jesus, says that he became to all those who obey him the author, or the source, rather, of eternal salvation. And in Romans 2 and verse 7, those who will receive eternal life are, quote, those who by perseverance in doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life. The glories of heaven, we all are aware of, are not going to be given on the basis of any sort of merit. But they will all be by grace. 2 Thessalonians 2:16. In heaven, we won't brag about the fact we're there, because there was nothing we could have done to get there. Our good works, nothing would have gotten us there. We could simply say, as Jesus said in Luke 17:10, we are unworthy servants. Heaven is given to us as inheritance. An inheritance is not earned. It's a gift. It's given to the recipient. Those who are heirs, the recipients, are those who are children of God. Romans 8, 16 and 17. Galatians 3, verses 6, 7, and 29. Those who will not enter heaven are those who rebel against God and live immoral lives. 1 Corinthians 6, verses 9 and 10. Galatians 5, verses 19 to 21. Because they have not been cleansed by the blood of Christ, they will remain defiled and cannot enter into heaven. Revelation 21, 27. 2 Peter 3, verse 13. Those who enter heaven will only be those who are cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Ephesians 5, verses 25 to 27. Colossians 1, verses 19 to 22. Next. next question. We'll all be rewarded the same. We're all going to get the same reward. Some have concluded that God will give different degrees of rewards. And pretty much from what I could read, they base this conclusion on the fact that in the New Testament, there are three different crowns that are talked about. There is the crown of righteousness, 2 Timothy 4, verse 8. We mentioned that this morning in talking about Paul saying that he had run the race and finished the course. The crown of righteousness was laid up for him, and not him alone, but all those that love the appearing of the Lord. There's also a crown of glory mentioned in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 4. And then there is a crown of life, Revelation 2 verse 10 and James 1 verse 12. Well, some look at those three different crowns and they make an argument, present the statement that yes, there will be levels of reward in heaven. However, these may not be degrees of war. In fact, I don't think they are. They are not degrees of rewards, but they are descriptions of blessings that are there for all the righteous. So, a good case then can be made for the opposite of that, that everyone's going to receive the same rewards. Think about Jesus' parable in Matthew 20. He told a parable there about some who were hired to go to work in the field of a landowner at various hours of the day. And they were simply told, go to work in the field. Go work in the field different hours through the day. From 1 hour to all day. Jesus stated that they all receive the same wage. He also taught that those who gave all would receive eternal life, Luke 18:39. But he said nothing about greater rewards or lesser rewards, just that all would receive eternal life. Now, if you think about it, God would be just to reward some more than others. However, when you think about the fact that no one deserves heaven, if God gives all the same reward as the parable indicated, 20, he's still going to be showing his grace to all. Alright, final question. Will we know each other? Will we recognize each other? Some argue that if we recognize each other, there will be grief in heaven. Because as we look around and recognize each other, to realize someone that I know and love and have known all of my life is not there. And that'll make me sad. And so they argue based upon that fact that if we realize that some loved ones didn't make it, that means there's grief in the Bible. The Bible says there is no grief, no crying, no mourning, no tears. However, those of us who go to heaven will understand God's justice as He does. For that reason, we will be satisfied. Whatever verdicts he gives. Others have concluded that that we will not recognize each other in heaven because our spiritual bodies won't look like our physical bodies look. We won't look the same as there as we do now. However, the parable that Jesus told, I said parable, some don't consider it a parable. In Luke 16, Jesus talked about the rich man and Lazarus, how they fared in this world, but they both died, and in the next world, the rich man recognized Lazarus. He knew who that was in Abraham's bosom. And he talked to Abraham and said, send Lazarus. Of course, the answer was, that can't be done. The rich man recognized Lazarus. And one other thing, Paul said, 1 Thessalonians 2, verses 19 and 20, that the Thessalonian brethren would be his reason for joy and glory at the coming of Jesus. Well, how could they be his reason for rejoicing if he couldn't recognize them? If he couldn't look over and see, hey, there's brothers, there's the so-and-sos from Thessalonica. I knew them well. How could he not recognize them and know that they were among the saved? In heaven, the righteous will enjoy the fellowship throughout eternity with saved friends they had on earth and with all the saved of all the earth. So I guess the answer to the question is, Scripture doesn't plainly say, but the implication to me is yes, we will know. I think we all believe that. As we talk about, when I get there, I'm going to ask Paul what he meant by that in that passage. And I'm going to say, Noah, tell me what it was like building the ark. And we make statements like that, implying that we do believe that we will recognize one another. Well, heaven's a wonderful place. Place that will exceed our most cherished dreams, imagination, visions here upon this earth. And the greatest aspiration that we ought to have on this earth is to be ready to and prepared to enter into that spiritual realm where Jesus is, to enjoy that spiritual existence throughout eternity in heaven, where there will be a wonderful fellowship. There will be no longer any pain, sorrow, or crying. Everything will be joy, happiness, and peace. I'm sure I haven't answered all your questions on this subject, but I told you what I can find. And I'm sure you probably, those of you who are taking notes, probably did not get everything written down that I mentioned. See me later. What a wonderful promise God has made. Your reward is great in heaven. You know, that's really all I care to know for now. What it's going to be like, what we're going to do, I don't care. I just want to be. I think I've told this before, but I'm going to tell it again. Stafford North, who taught for a number of years on the Bible faculty at Oklahoma Christian, and I think he's been here, if I remember right, and did a seminar on the Book of Revelation. I heard him do that at Broken Arrow when we were back on furlough one year from Ukraine. And the thing that, I mean, the whole thing was impressive. I really liked his material and what he said and what he did. But one of the things that really impressed me is that he said in his family, they have a signal, a code word. It's simply this. Be there. And that says to every one of them, be there. Do what you have to do to be there in heaven. To be there when the time comes. Whether it's your own death or whether it's the return of the Lord. Be ready so that you can be there in heaven. That's all of us need to be doing right now. Being prepared to be there. There's something that we can do this evening to help you in your preparation, your readiness to be there. I want you to come and let that be known.
Sorrow and care, hearts are lonely and drear, burdens are lifted at Calvary, Jesus is very near. Burdens are lifted at Calvary, burdens are lifted at Calvary, Jesus is very near. Troubled soul, the Savior can see, every heartache and tear. Burdens are lifted at Calvary, Jesus is very near. Burdens are lifted at Calvary, Calvary, Calvary. Burdens are lifted at Calvary, Jesus is very near.
Thanks a lot for that lesson, Denny. We had a fire hazard up here on the front row. My ink pen was smoking. And I didn't get every verse, but I got nearly all of them. Really appreciate this series Denny has brought us. Gets our minds centered on things we need to be thinking about and things that we need to focus on and have at the forethought of our thoughts as we go through our daily lives. Our closing song this evening is number 882, and we'll be led in a closing prayer by Dean Wiseman. 882. Let's sing the first and third verses.
No tears in heaven, no sorrows given, all will be glory in that land. There'll be no sadness, all will be gladness, when we shall join that happy band. No tears, no tears up there. Sorrow and pain will all have flown. No tears, no tears, no tears up there. No tears in heaven will be known. Some morning yonder we'll cease to ponder o'er things this life has brought to view. All will be clearer, save ones be dearer, in heaven where all will be made new. No tears, no tears. tears, no tears up there. Sorrow and pain will all have flown. No tears, no tears, no tears up there. No tears in heaven will be known.
Let's pray together. Holy God, Father who art in heaven, what a blessing this day has been, your day. Beginning, Father, with this morning in Bible class, where Dale has emphasized living for Jesus, to avoid those false teachers, those hollow teachers, trying to lead us away. For Denny, as he continues, for Mike, as he chose his songs this morning, walking with Jesus, being with Jesus. Then as Denny brought the lesson to us this morning, building on with Jesus, living for Jesus, the beauty of it, the things we need to watch for. Count the blessings that we're able to do. And then he put a cap on it this night. The results of living with Jesus, that reward that awaits us, the faithful, the joys of heaven. When that time comes, there'll not be a long, long line. Will all come in just the twinkling of an eye. Time will be no more. The faithful will go receive their reward. The disobedient will receive theirs. But what a day that will be. We'll get to see Jesus. We'll see our God. We'll be with the redeemed of all ages. With joy, we're singing in worship. Mike concluded that same thought while ago as he chose his lesson, his song. No tears in heaven. That's just one of the few things that we'll enjoy. We accepted to by being faithful to Jesus. What a thing to look forward to. What a blessing it will be. We sing the song sometime. How beautiful. The many joys that we'll share. What a waste.